Her words are one of the top retweets in America.
As children of God, we should learn to imitate our Heavenly Father. He uses words to create, and we need to do that too.
Joyce Meyer on the power of the spoken word on today's 700 Club Interactive. On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today. Well, welcome to the show. It's been said by many a mother that if you have nothing nice to say, then don't say anything at all. And today's guest has written a whole book about this. It's called Change Your Words, Change Your Life. What you say can actually determine how you live your life.
That's right. New York Times best-selling author Joyce Meyer is one of America's leading Bible teachers, and she believes that the key to happiness is in the spoken word.
No one appreciates me.
I'll never get that promotion.
I am so stressed out. No one ever notices me.
I'm not respected.
I never have enough time.
Nothing I do is right.
I'm a failure.
I have nothing to offer.
No one will ever find me attractive.
I wish I was
better,
smarter,
skinnier,
prettier.
No one understands me.
No one will ever love me.
I'll always be alone.
What do your words
say about you?
Change your words, change your life.
Well, joining us now via Skype is international best-selling author and teacher Joyce Meyer. Joyce, it's a privilege to have you on the show today.
Well, thanks. Technology where I can just stay here in my town and have an interview with you and yours.
I love this technology, but this technology is getting us in trouble, isn't it? Have you noticed that the talk on the internet, particularly on message boards, comment boards, tweets, that it tends to be very negative, and people take all the filters off and really sort of let it rip out there? Why is that?
Well, I think the world is negative, but God is not, and his people should not be. So we have a great opportunity in the midst of a negative atmosphere to be even more positive than ever and to show people the different fruit that you can bear when you keep a good attitude.
Well, in your book, Change Your Words, Change Your Life, you have a whole section on self-talk. And if the psychologists, psychiatrists are right, most of us are talking to ourselves and are talking to ourselves in very negative terms and doing that pretty much on a constant basis. Why is that? Why is that coming out in our hearts, even about ourselves?
Well, you know, the Bible says that God's got a great plan for our lives, but we have to have our mind renewed in order to experience that plan. So, you know, before I really learned the word, I only knew one way to think, and we talk however we think, and that was according to what my circumstances had been, which had not been good, and according to what I saw other people doing. But as I learned the word of God, I began to have my mind renewed, and I always like to say that you'll never have what God wants you to have unless you learn to think like God thinks and speak like God speaks. And the good thing about it is we don't have to wait for something to just come up for us to say. We can choose our words and choose our thoughts, and we should do so very carefully because words are containers for power. A lot of times I'll just use a glass as an example and say, I can fill this full of tasty lemonade or I can fill it full of mud. It's up to me. And my words and your words, everybody's words, contain power. They can carry God's power, creative, life-changing power, or they can carry the power of the devil in them, which is everything negative and bad. The thief comes only to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus said, I came that you might have and enjoy your life, have it in abundance to the full until it overflows. So when we learn to choose our words and to change our words, we really can see a life change.
I like to tell people that your words today actually determine your tomorrow. That you literally can prophesy over yourself, and you can prophesy doom or you can prophesy good things. And to a degree, it's almost like God's given children loaded firearms to determine our own future. Why are our words so powerful?
Well, God's word is what changes our life. And God was the first one with words. He said, let there be light. God said, let there be light. He didn't just think it. He didn't just imagine it. He said, let there be light, and there was light. his word was so full of power that it created something that we still enjoy today, which is light. And so we have an example in the very beginning of the Bible that what we say has power. We know that from being raised by negative parents, if we have negative words spoken over us for lots of years, then it's going to affect us in a negative way. If you have somebody who's had a lot of encouragement, a lot of positive things spoken to them and about them, they're not going to have a difficult time overcoming their past because they had a good beginning. And so as children of God, we should learn to imitate our Heavenly Father. And He uses words to create, and we need to do that too. Now, I do think it's important to say that we can't just prophesy anything we want and get it. You know, I'm certainly not trying to go back to what some people call the name it, claim it gospel. I don't believe in that, but I do believe that we can speak God's word and see God's word come to pass. And, you know, God says, for example, every day is a new beginning. So I can get up and say and believe. I don't have to be affected by yesterday's mistakes. Today is a new day. It's the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad. I can say while I'm still in need, all of my needs are met according to God's riches and glory by Christ Jesus, because that's what the word tells me to say. And actually, we can increase our own joy by speaking according to the word of God, or we can decrease our joy. We can let our joy leak out by saying negative things. And, you know, a lot of people ask the question, well, you know, I have a negative circumstance. How can I, if somebody says to me, how are you? How can I stay positive and not lie to them? And basically what I just tell them is you just need to put the best connotation on it that you can. You know, I don't have to say, oh, my life is a mess and I'm this and I'm that and I'm broke and nothing's ever going to change. I can say, you know, I am going through a rough time right now, but you know what? God is helping me. He's on my side. I believe His word is true. And I know that this is not going to last forever, that I've got a great future. So there are ways to deal with what you need to deal with. And, you know, I'm not suggesting we ignore reality, but I am strongly suggesting, based on the Bible, that we begin to see things from a standpoint of faith rather than seeing things from a standpoint of the way the world would look at it without God's word.
How do we speak things that grieve the Holy Spirit? Why do certain words seem to do that?
Well, if you read all of Ephesians 4, where it says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit, the few verses before verse 30, Ephesians 4:30, and the few verses after it are all talking about anger and bitterness and the way that people talk to one another, unkind words, harsh words, things like that. And it does very much grieve the Holy Spirit when God's children don't get along, when they're mean to one another, when they gossip about one another, when they won't forgive one another. So we need to set aside all those things through the power of the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says become useful and kind to one another. You know, I like to teach people, and I'm sure you do too. If there's 8 things about someone that you don't like and 2 things that you do, then don't talk about the 8 things you don't like, because that's not going to make that person change. It's only going to actually drive them further into the problem. But encourage them with the 2 things that you do like, build them up, edify them, magnify the things that you do like, and give God an opportunity to work on the things that you don't like. So I think most of the way that we grieve the Holy Spirit with our words, although I think even being negative about your future is grievous to the Holy Spirit, because then we're putting ourselves in a position where we're not going to be able to have the plan that God has for us. He wants us to say what's going to help us, not what's going to hurt us. But I also think a lot of what grieves the Holy Spirit is when people don't talk to one another and treat one another kindly. I tell people all the time, God does not take kindly to it when we mistreat one another. He wants us to treat each other as if we have value and are precious because we are in God's sight.
What would you tell someone that's just sort of waking up to this, that their self-talk is negative, their outward talk is negative, they've been unkind to others? What would you tell them would be the first step to start the process of literally changing how they think, changing their heart, so that their words come into alignment with what God's word is? What's the first step?
Well, I think I would start by repenting, which basically means to admit where you're at and then be willing to turn and go in another direction. I would pray and receive God's forgiveness for all the negative things that I had said in the past. And then I would definitely ask God to help me, to give me his grace, which is his undeserved favor, to go forward. The truth is we can't change without God's help. He always wants us to lean on him. And so daily I will pray, God, help me with my words today. Put a watch over my mouth, lest I sin against you with my tongue. I choose to speak excellent things today, but I need your help to do it. So don't ever try to do anything without God's help. Then study what the Word of God says about words. It's amazing, even if you just go through Proverbs, and if you're willing to underline in your Bible, everywhere where you see the mouth or words, if you underline what the Bible says about it, you begin to get that principle down on the inside of you of how important that subject is in the Word of God. It's really all over the Bible that we need to use wisdom in what we say. And so if you want to say what God says, you have to know what God says. And the only way to do that is to begin to study his word. And I always tell people, if you've never done anything, then don't look at everything that you need to change all at one time. Pick an area, begin small, stick with it till you get a breakthrough, then keep at it, choose something else. We need to form new habits. And in some ways, talking negatively has just become habitual in people's lives. They, first of all, don't know that it's hurting them. And secondly, it's just a habit. You know, I mean, that's what the world does. It's just a habit. So we can make new habits. We can actually break bad habits by making good habits. So the best thing to do, Gordon, is just start. You know, we never get anywhere unless we start. And I would pray and ask that the Holy Spirit would show you each time that you are being negative, because initially we're just doing things and don't even realize that we're doing them. So pray that the Holy Spirit would show you each time that you are being negative, and then ask him to help you be positive.
All right, Joyce, great advice. Thanks for being with us. The book is called Change Your Words, Change Your Life. It's available nationwide, wherever books are sold. And if you want more information on her, all you have to do is go to our website, 700 Club Interactive. We'll link you over to Joyce. Joyce, thanks for being with us.
Thanks again. Bye.
Terry?
Well, still ahead, a young boy's prayers for his grandmother are answered in an unusual way when we come back.
I started feeling pain between my spine and my shoulder blade. All I had was pain and no relief. There was a sizable mass consistent with a malignant cancer in upper right lung. And that's complex, that's tough stuff. I was walking, talking, but I didn't know how sick I was.
I remembered seeing the ad for Cancer Treatment Centers of America, and I thought, this is the place he needs to be.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The game plan was chemotherapy and radiation throughout the whole period. It was an aggressive plan of attack, and I liked that.
We gave him chemotherapy and radiation. He was an amazing patient. He tolerated treatment exceptionally well.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity. And the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
My strength came back. I began to become myself again.
George does have his life back now. He has a life that I never thought he was gonna have.
With the teamwork, the treatment plans, the facilities, the combination of all the aspects of the treatment, I'm so happy that I went to CTCA.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
In India, Orphans Promise has been working hard to bring relief to children who are suffering there. Children like Jaskaran and Simran. Watch this.
An orphanage was the last place Jaskaran and Simran wanted to be. But their grandmother was sick and couldn't take care of them anymore. Her only choice was to bring them here, a Christian children's home in Delhi, India, sponsored by Orphans Promise.
I used to be very sad and cried a lot. I wanted to go home to my grandma. And what made it even harder was that all the kids here were Christians, but my sister and I were Sikhs.
Jaskaran refused to do his schoolwork and wouldn't play with the other kids. He also worried about his grandmother and prayed to the Sikh God to heal her, but she didn't get any better.
I was angry with my God for not healing my grandma. I loved her a lot. The other children at the home told me that Jesus could heal anybody. So I decided to see if what they said was true. I prayed to Jesus for my grandma's health. I also prayed with the other kids and house parents.
It wasn't long before Jaskaran and Simran received great news.
I found out that my grandma was completely healed. I ran and shared it with the other children. They reminded me about my challenge to God, and I agreed to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Then I started to pray and read the Bible.
Jaskaran couldn't wait to share what he had learned with his sister.
Jesus is the one who was crucified for all our sins. I had never heard anything like that before. I cried and later accepted Lord Jesus as my personal Savior.
Jaskaran and Simran are doing well in school and have made lots of friends.
I thank God for bringing me to this home. I get good food to eat and new clothes to wear. But what matters the most is that I now have Jesus in my life.
Jaskaran is a wonderful young man, and that place is a wonderful home. And it's your giving that makes it possible for us to come alongside of the pastor and his wife who run that home for these children and to help them. We've been able to provide school supplies for them. We've been able to provide beds and mattresses. You are making that kind of outreach to children in need around the world available. Most of all, the message of the love of God, that they have a Father who loves them, who will never leave them or forsake them. If you would like to be a part of the work that Orphans Promise is doing in countries all around the world with children who've been left behind, lost, abandoned because of drugs, illness, war, poverty, you can do that by giving and calling this number to give your gift, 888-777-1999, or you can give to Orphans Promise by logging on to CBN.com. Gordon?
Well, coming up, a camper falls off a cliff and lands in a river 60 feet below.
I knew something was wrong, and I looked up, and Carter wasn't to be seen. From that moment on, I thought he was dead.
Find out how he survived the fall. That's up next.
A deadly illness that has no cure.
To my chagrin, there was nothing that could be done for her.
ALS is also known as Lou Gehrig's disease.
It's not just nerve cells that die, but muscle cells die.
But is there a way to slow its progression?
5 years. I think I'm doing pretty darn good.
A remarkable new treatment for ALS. On the 700 Club, next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the total transformation free.
Carter Crutchfield was on a camping trip with friends. And then a freak accident sent him flying off a cliff and into the frigid waters, 60 feet below.
College buddies Carter Crutchfield and Patrick Dauphin went camping in North Alabama with a few friends.
Found the perfect, most beautiful campsite right over this 60-foot valley, and I thought it'd be perfect.
Everything was going as planned. The tents were up, the campfire was burning.
Then the fire starts to die down, and I guess that's where the incident starts to happen.
The guys split up to look for more firewood.
Had a big limb that I put behind the fire. And so I was jumping on top of it to try to get it to crack. And either one of two things happened, and one was I couldn't get it to break and it acted as a springboard and threw me backwards, or it broke before I was expecting and then it cracked and then I fell backwards after I losing my balance.
I knew something was wrong and I looked up and Carter wasn't to be seen. So I knew immediately what had happened.
Carter fell 60 feet into the river below, bouncing off a smaller ledge on the way down.
I told Miller to immediately go get cell phone service and try to call for help. It took me 2 minutes to get down to that smaller ledge, realized he wasn't there. So I immediately backtracked, ran back through. Finally, after about 3-4 minutes, made my way back to the river.
Carter wasn't floating, so Patrick searched under the water.
After 2 or 3 times of failing, I kicked something. Something movable object. I knew what it was. Brought Carter to the surface. You know, it didn't even look like Carter. From that moment on, I thought he was dead.
Patrick and Keith pulled Carter to the edge of the water. Patrick started CPR.
8 minutes passed. I was getting tired. Keith Gray and I swapped positions. I held him up on the rock, held his neck stable, and he began the chest compressions. After a few more minutes, we swapped again. Then we heard this gurgling noise. It sounded, it was just like almost like a drain. Water going down a drain.
They did CPR for 12 minutes until Carter started to breathe. Then he only took one shallow breath per minute. Carter's shoulder blade was visible. His ear was partially torn off, but the most life-threatening injury was 2 collapsed lungs. The paramedics and a helicopter arrived 45 minutes after the accident. At the hospital, the doctors had his parents fill out organ donor forms.
The surgeon basically told us that his condition was grave and that his chances of survival were slim. We're guessing that he was oxygen deprived somewhere between 20 minutes or more. So a long time. The guidance that we were being given from the medical staff early on was that some level of serious cognitive impairment was to be expected.
Carter made it through the night, but Patrick and Carter's dad knew prayer was their only hope.
Right when we got there, Mr. Crutchfield led us into a prayer, and he started a website, or posting at a website called caringbridge.org, and where he posted Carter's updates and put specific things to pray for.
And so we'd only put, you know, 4 or 5 specific requests each update, but here's where the miracle was, is that each, and I'm going to get emotional, because between each update, the specific requests were being answered. So there was no question that he was answering our petitions.
Every single prayer, everything he said to pray for actually miraculously came true. I think I looked one time and he had been posting it for a couple of days and there was over 1,300 responses.
There was this intimacy that I can only envision as being what, you know, heaven is going to be like in some way, right? Because you just had this, you knew that these people were praying for you and your family, and there was the common bond of Christ that was connecting us.
After 2 weeks, Carter woke from a coma.
He was himself when he woke up. It was truly, from our perspective, miraculous.
I feel like it really was a miracle, just to the simple stats that the doctors gave and the chances they gave me for survival, and just falling 60 to 65 feet off a cliff and surviving, I feel like just the fact that God allowed me to survive and kind of gave that opportunity to me is a miracle.
God heard the prayers of all these people on our behalf to pray for our son, and he answered them, and to his glory.
It is always to his glory. To him belongs all the power, the glory, the kingdom forever and ever. And what do we need to access into that? Just faith like a little child that believes when Daddy promises he is able and will deliver at the time that he says he's going to deliver. And so they took God at his word. Now, they could have taken the doctors at their word. Those words are very powerful. The words of a doctor's diagnosis can be very powerful. And it can literally turn into an ownership where you start saying, my cancer, or my disease, or my infirmity, and you start to own it instead of rejecting it, saying, well, that's not God's promise over me. God's promise over me is that he heals every disease. He has taken away all my pain, all my infirmity, and by his stripes I am healed. That's God's report. So let's believe that. And just as that wonderful family did in that story, let's just bring our petitions to God, knowing that if we pray in accordance with his will, and we know his will is to heal, so if we pray in accordance with that, we know he hears. And if he hears, we know we have what we've requested. And so they did it incrementally, and they didn't look at the symptoms anymore. They said, okay, here's what we need right now. Let's get that. And so they did that. And here's what we need next. Let's pray that, and they got that. So just believe. Just be like a little child and believe. Now, if you're sick, lay your hand on that area of the body that needs healing. Terry and I are going to agree. Demetri is here. She's going to agree. We've got a great viewing audience. They're going to agree. And we're going to create a great circle of prayer. We're going to claim this wonderful verse. These are the words of God. And these are the words of Jesus. If two or more agree touching anything, it shall be done. We're not making it up. You can find it in the Bible. Two or more agree touching anything, it shall be done. So let's agree, and let's touch, and let God do the rest. Let's pray. Lord, we just come together in agreement, and we lift up the needs of the audience, and Lord, we're bold enough to hope against hope, to not consider the deadness, to not consider the doctor's report, to not consider even the organ donation report, but we come into agreement, touching, and we say, be healed now, in Jesus' name. We say to the barren, be fruitful now, and conceive and have a child. We say to those with brain injury, be healed, be restored. We pray for those with nervous affliction, for Parkinson's, for MS, we come into agreement for them and say, be healed now, in Jesus' name. Terry, what's God saying to you?
Also people with lupus and fibromyalgia, but there, even as Gordon was praying, that there is at least one person, you are listening right now, you're with us right now, and you have been struggling with infertility, and you say, do I even dare to believe when doctors have said no, that God would do this for me? God has heard your plea, and you are going to have a child.
Lord, we just come into agreement, and we speak over that couple the power to give life, to bear life through full gestation, and to have a wonderful, healthy, normal child. Give them the peace that passes all understanding. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report. So give us a call. Let us know what God has done for you. 888-777-1999. And we're here for you. It's our honor to pray with you. So if you need somebody to agree with you, just give us a call. We leave you this wonderful word from Proverbs, a cheerful heart is good medicine. But a broken spirit saps a person's strength. Be cheerful today. Go out and smile at the world. Tell people that you love them. Tell them that God loves them too. We'll see you again.